Obviously per week.
Yes. Yeah.
Just imagine what sort of effect that was having in Golden. Yeah. 100%.
The impacts are behind. 381 TBA.
Thanks for joining us to today's program of the Valley's People. I have two fascinating guests for you. The first is someone that for some 40-odd years of his working life has been reporting every major and some minor events from the Hunter Valley. And secondly, a lady from Lambton who just a little while ago decided to place on record something that most of us never ever knew before. I hope you can join us for today's program. Thanks for joining us. Our first guest today is Matt Hayes, a name that most of us have known with everything that's ever happened in the Hunter Valley for some years now. And I guess most people feel they know you, Matt, but I guess we don't really know what ticks.
Yes, that may be true, Ron. Yes.
The first thing that comes out when you start asking other people, particularly your peer group, journalists, about Matt Hayes is the fact that I think the first thing they say is that you've gone to the oddest extremes and the oddest places to interview people in the Hunter Valley.
Ron, this is probably true. I mean, it's true of most journalists too, you know. Most journalists are fairly enterprising people, and they've got to be if they're going to get a story. And the people who go out into the streets, the reporters, have got to be enterprising, or else they just fail to get their story. They fail in their jobs. And
But some are more enterprising.
Well, perhaps so, yes. Right. Talking, you know, on that score, I suppose one that comes to mind, Ron, the most recent, and perhaps I shouldn't be doing these after around about 40 years, but I had a chance to go out when the new floating dock was being brought here from Japan, and I had the thought that it would be a great thing if perhaps I could get out to sea and meet it. It was being towed here, of course. And meet it and be the first Australian to actually step ashore on the floating dock when it was being brought here to Newcastle. So I arranged initially for the police launch to take us out. We went outside, Milton Merrilies and I, the photographer at that time, but it was blowing a gale and the conditions were anything but good. We went out about 5-7 miles in the police boat. We couldn't find the floating dock. So we came back. The next morning we found that it had, you know, it too had had some trouble with the weather. So the next morning I got a little tug that operates here in the port and Don Brewster and I went out in the tug. And we found, this time we found the floating dock. It was being towed, nobody on board. We were in about an 8-foot swell. The floating dock was pounding up and down in the seas. We didn't know quite how we were going to get on board, but anyway, we had an intrepid tugmaster who said, "I can put you aboard." There was just a Jacob's ladder at the back, you see. So he manoeuvred us on, and with this thing pounding down, and we grabbed the ladder, and I got up first and stood up on this huge dock, you know, the first man on board sort of thing. And then Don came on board and shot I remember a very good shot from a long shot with this great expanse of floating dock and me alone there on the floor, which was very good piece of news and a good, an excellent photograph.
Oh, incredible. You know, royal entrance to Newcastle.
Absolutely.
On a floating dock. What more do you need?
The problem was, Ron, that we hadn't made arrangements to get off. So 3 hours later, we found that we were stranded there. We couldn't get our picture off. We couldn't get our story off. We had no contact. And it looked as if all that was going to be wasted. But we happened to sight a little runabout about 200 yards away, and only about a 14-footer. So I managed we hailed it and signalled it wildly and managed to get it up. Well, so it's only a little 14-footer. And we offered him $20 or anything you'd like to nominate to take us ashore. So he was also rather intrepid because I was certainly wouldn't have risked my boat in that in those circumstances. But he did so, and he brought this thing right up to the floating dock, and it was pounding down, and he was almost underneath it as it went up out of the seas. Anyway, we had to jump from that into that little 14-footer. Donnie got safely on board, and I had to make my jump. And I tell you what, it looked so very small, and I just closed my eyes and jumped. I just narrowly hit the deck of the small deck of this thing, and I fell and went over, and managed just to hang on as I went over, and we got back, and we had the picture, and we had the story.
Yes, but it could be Matt Hayes, who never ever will jump from a leaping fire balcony into one of those little nets again.
I made that resolution when I got back, right?
Yes. Matt, the other picture we get, of course, of you always being there first. Other people have said to me, you'll find Matt already in the back seat of the car when you go to meet the VIP.
That's the name of the game.
Is that just your own research and plotting and tracking of these people's movements? I mean,
well, it's largely that, Ron. Pardon me. That's the sort of the name of the game too. I remember, also going back some years, we had Sir Anthony Eden here. This was after he'd had that rather brief and disastrous period as Prime Minister, which was upset by the Egypt affair. And he was visiting here, and I wanted to interview him, and he was pretty difficult to get to, you know, to interview personally. But I had some good friends, and I arranged, he was going to make just a quick little trip around Newcastle to have a quick look, and they were going to show him. So I arranged that we would go round via Nobby's. And they suggested to him that, they had somebody who knew the history of Nobby's and of the waterfront there rather well, and we'd stop there for a moment, and this observer would fill him in, you see. Well, I happened to be the observer, and so I slipped into the back seat of the car with Sir Anthony Eden, and I was able to tell him very briefly what he wanted to know, and he, just as briefly, was able to tell me what I wanted to know.
Yes, what happens when you see those childhood Hollywood movies of press reporters. That's what it is. Matt, another thing about you that, of course, I'm fairly familiar with is the fact that your voice really has been the voice over many years now that's conveyed the stories of the Hunter Valley to the whole of Australia through Macquarie News and also overseas as well.
Yes.
Do you remember any particular stories that have meant a lot to you in voice reporting?
Well, I started with Macquarie, Ron, when back in the floods of 54-55, and I did the broadcasting for Macquarie of those disastrous floods of 55, and that sort of started me with Macquarie.
I think I was in another duck at the time.
You were indeed. That's right. And I've been reporting for the Macquarie Network ever since then without break, which sort of makes me their veteran correspondent. And I have been in some extraordinary circumstances, been broadcasting under extraordinary circumstances. I remember that at the that rather tragic murder of the policeman at Toronto, I was there when and trying to do a voice broadcast for Macquarie when the police, I was doing it in the Toronto Country Club, when the police brought in the man who was later charged with the murder and stood him beside me while I endeavoured to do a voice broadcast and to describe the scene and what the police were doing, which was rather awkward. But Ron, one of the best scoops in terms of radio, I think, came not so terribly long ago. People will recall the plane crash at Carr Springs up in the Barrington tops, not the most recent crash, but the crash which preceded that. And I went up overnight. I was called out overnight. We went up and slept outside Scone Police Station so that we'd be there first thing in the morning and we could go out with the police. And we scooted after them out to Carr Springs. We were the only newsmen there at that time, a photographer and I, David Wicks. And the location of the crashed plane was fairly well known. It was up in the valley, in a very heavily timbered valley. We went up into that valley, and and I stayed, David went up and I stayed at headquarters, and we got word, a very dramatic word, over two-way radio, that the plane had been found and that two of the occupants were dead, but the young girl in that plane was lying badly injured, upside down, in the smashed wreckage of the plane, but she was alive. And that message came through, and then I was able, fortunately, because it broke just before 9 o'clock in the morning, and I was able to go on air at that time and break the news that that girl was alive and the plane had been found.
Yes, they talk about hardened journalists, but I guess it was a fairly emotive moment.
It is indeed.
Yeah,
yes.
Matt, you've surrounded yourself with the life of the Hunter Valley, and you and people both have had this incredible relationship. I know it's going to be an awkward question, but it's always fascinated me, seeing you've met so many people. I just wonder whether you could nominate 10 or 12, or, you know, who are the people of the Hunter Valley that have had such a profound interest upon you? Well, maybe a better question, the profound interest on the people in your judgment.
Joe, Ron, that's a pretty stiff one, isn't it?
You'd like us to move on to show business?
No. I could answer that, I suppose, in these terms, that it's true, Ron. I've seen the Valley, and it's been one of the fascinating things of my life, that that having remained here most of my life, when sometimes opportunity came to go to Sydney or Melbourne or around Australia, but I would imagine that among the people that I would regard as people who've influenced the Valley's development in this tremendous way, if I were to take, say, civic affairs, for example, I would have to nominate probably Frank Perdue as one of the men that has impressed me most as having contributed a great deal. But in that respect too, if I were to ask who was the most extraordinary man that I'd met in civic affairs, it would have to be Harry Quinlan, big Harry Quinlan, who was the first Lord Mayor and who was an extraordinary fellow. And I knew him very well because he was a fellow journalist.
That's two.
If I were to talk in terms of commerce, I think I would personally put at the top of my list Richard Owens. Richie Owens, I think, is a man who's shown tremendous enterprise in business, and he has influenced a lot of other people in this region in terms of business. I would also put there too, and one would have to put there, but he's a little in broader terms, Alex Young.
Yes.
In trade union affairs, industrial affairs, which are terribly important, I would think Alec Dowling, who was the secretary of the Trades Hall Council for many years and a most astute man. We disagreed on the politics a great deal, but I had to concede, you know, I admired him and always. In the other side of industry, one of the men who impressed me, I didn't know Essington Lewis, but I did know Keith Butler of the BHP. Yeah. BHP manager. He was one of those who helped bring the BHP out of isolation into the spotlight. Who else could we nominate in among women? I couldn't go past Joy Cummings. Joy Cummings has changed the nature of women's role, I think, in this in this valley.
Yeah.
Jove, what would we talk? Theatre. I would say that one would have to nominate Colin Chapman as one of the greatest influences on theatre here. In up to recently, the man now who is influencing theatre here most in the most vigorous way is Arnie Neamy, who's the artistic director of the Hunter Valley Theatre Company, who's given a new dimension to regional theatre here. How many have I counted?
I don't know, but there's certainly a list there. I mean, as you read those names out, I'm sure, along with me, our viewers could be just about pinpointing those people in the development of the Hunter Valley, and that's quite fantastic. And so is your contribution, Matt Hayes. Thank you very much for being with us today on The Valley's People. It's been a pleasure.
It's a great pleasure.
We have an interesting lady next, someone who does some things a lot of us might even aspire to, and I'd like you to stay with us. Welcome back to The Valley's People. My next guest has written this booklet about the Barrington Tops Guest House, a landmark within the Hunter Valley, but it's something apart from those that have or go there or have gone there for holidays, a lot of us know very little about. In fact, I think that's what I find very fascinating about this book, is that we didn't know very much about it until Therese Atchison started to put these things together. Firstly, congratulations on a fine booklet.
Thank you
very much. I really enjoyed that, Therese.
Thank you. The
thing that strikes me about the opening of the Barrington Guest House was the fact that on the opening day it really was a wedding, wasn't it?
Oh, it was a gala occasion. They had everyone there. Tourist League, the heavies from the government, the people from the Dungog Hospital. The Ladies Auxiliary were given the opportunity to raise some funds for the hospital by catering for dinner, and they did that, and they raised £30 doing that. Just seemed to be everyone, the Lord Mayor of Newcastle and Maitland and Tourist League and everyone who was anyone was
New South
there.
Wales government officials, everyone arrived.
Yes, the local members, yeah. All these people were there. It makes me feel it must have had some sort of a tourism, well not a backing, but that they were just behind it all as a tourist thing.
Maybe they're dealing with people with foresight that realised just what a wonderful thing it was going to be.
Well, they did. Someone urged them all to see Australia first, and that was in 1930. Mm. So they had some foresight there.
And what was the day? What are we talking about, the opening day? What date was that?
The 13th of December 1930. I think it was a Saturday. I'm sure it was a Saturday. They had a motorcade organised from Dungog to get the people up there, because not everyone had a car in those days.
Right.
The road was not very good. They had the NRMA standing by just in case. And one lady who'd done very well because of being a woman driver had done, she said, it wasn't quite as bad as she expected. they had about 300 people there for the day.
Really?
And 200 dancing on the verandas and in the dining room at night.
Isn't that incredible?
It was a great day for Dungog.
And it was a Dungog hotel proprietor that really built it.
Yes, Norm MacLeod. He had wanted to build a guest house somewhere very close to the state forest, and he raised the necessary money in about 1925 and bought the land. It's freehold land that Barrington House is on. It's not in the state forest itself. And he raised that money and they built it. And they got timber from the site itself and dressed it there. Must have it took 5 years to build, because they couldn't just ring up the local timber yard. and they got it finished.
Yeah, incredible.
It took a long time.
And why this document? How did you get involved in putting down this history for all time?
I wrote this because Lynn Lewis asked me to.
The current owners?
Yes. Lynn and Darrell were living in our neighbourhood at Lambton at the time. I was going to the university absorbing John Turner's history lectures. Fabulous. And Lynn asked me, she said, when you're over there, ask some of the people if they know anything about Barrington House. No one did. They said there'd nothing been written, nothing at all. So I went back to Lynn and I bludged a cup of coffee and I said, there's nothing. And she said, well, you're going to have to write it yourself. I said, Lynn, I can't. I left school when I was 14. I can't write a book. And there it is.
There it is, I'd say. Well, not only have you written a book, but you've written a book for posterity.
Yeah, that's I'm proud of that. I delivered a copy to the Library of New South Wales a little while ago, and I felt very proud to do that.
Yes.
There were thicker volumes there, definitely, but I wrote it, and I'm happy with it.
Now, what did you find out about the guest house and the type of construction and the problems they had?
Well, I suppose there were problems because of its isolation. There would have been transport problems. I don't think it was just an ordinary sort of building.
How did they cope with, the things we take for granted, like refrigeration and heating? And
oh, that sort of thing. Well, they had this very unique refrigerator, like a cool room. It was sort of lined with sawdust. And they closed the door, opened the door at night, let all the night air in, and it seemed to cool the meat. And they closed it during the day, and there was no way you were allowed to open that door during the day. And Darrell said that is definitely right, because he was under the guest house recently doing some work and all this sawdust fell down on him. And he said that must have been right, what she said. And the hot water service, that fascinates me, it's hot water service.
Tell me about that.
They got all their water from the river, but with an electric pump. They generated their own electricity.
Right.
But they also had a spring coming down from the mountain. And they made this arrangement of pipes, I suppose it was, with a fire underneath, and they kept that fire burning all the time, and that heated the water. That was their hot water service. It must have been unique. We don't think of these things these days.
No, no.
And that's why I'm glad I got that into the book.
Right. And of course, with they've had two enormous bushfire hazards there, haven't they?
Oh, yes.
It's really destroyed.
Asked Darrell Lewis about the last one, a couple of Christmas, I think, I forget which Christmas, but they were really worried, and they evacuated all the guests, took them down to Salisbury, and they tried to fight the fire. And then all the guests decided they'd come back and help fight it. But it was very worrying for them. It came right through the rainforest and everything. It was terrible. The one in 1941 was equally bad. They nearly lost the guest house both times. Yeah. I hope that never happens again.
No, it's so much part of Hunter Valley, isn't it? I mean, even the people that don't go know about it, and they'd love to go sometime.
Yes, it's one of the few guest houses so very, very close to a state forest. They can be taken on a four-wheel drive vehicle and be right in the state forest, in the rainforest. It's beautiful. It really is lovely.
Therese, you must have met a lot of fascinating people. Standard question, but I'm absorbed in the people that you would have got find out what the conditions were like. Because I read in your book that the tariff was 10 shillings a day three guineas a week, so it was pretty upper strata, wasn't it?
I think so. I think it was only fairly well-to-do people who could have gone there, because that was almost a week's wages,
right?
If you think of it in terms of today. The people, that was the good thing about writing the book, was the people I met. It was marvellous. These were people who were young maids, waitresses in those 1930s, and they have very, very good memories. Mm-hmm. And the tales they told me, it was really heaps of fun just talking to them. I couldn't get down everything they told me, but it was really great just talking to them and meeting.
And when you met a waitress, you actually could remember what the conditions were like
there. Absolutely, down to the last detail, what she wore and how she ironed. There was one lady there, she was did a lot of the washing and ironing, and they had those heavy, you know, damask serviettes in those days. And I said, "Now look, Ethel, now what sort of an iron?" She said, an ordinary iron. And of course she meant one of those things you stick on the fuel stove.
Yes, hardly steam and dry.
No, but I was supposed to know what an ordinary iron was.
Yes.
I felt silly.
There's something else that you've done in the book too, which might clear a mystery up, because most people that have been to the Barrington Guest House have stood in front of the old fireplace and they've seen this aircraft propeller. I guess they've seen it now for 20, 30, 40 years.
Yes.
But for the first time, you've explained that. I mean, the first time that anyone's learnt the story.
Yes, I was glad to be able to do that. The Air Force office in Canberra provided me with that information. It was two young pilots during the war, Pilot Officer Bidstrup and Pilot Officer Warren, and they were doing exercises from Williamtown and crashed there, and they couldn't find them. They didn't find the wreckage until... That happened in April 1945. They didn't find the wreckage till January 1946. And they were then buried in Sandgate Cemetery. And I'm really glad that I could put that in a book for history and that propeller is there in front of the fireplace as a memorial to those men who lost their lives in those beautiful mountains.
Yes, I was asking about that in some of the locals up there. They still maintain that after the aircraft crashed, that there seemed to be some evidence that they cleared a landing strip to try and take off again. Have you been able to prove or disprove that in your research?
I couldn't prove it. The people who found the aeroplane had found that that fencing had been rolled back, and it appeared that an airstrip had been tried to be formed. And we think that they crash landed and tried to repair the plane, taken off on their makeshift airstrip and crashed into a tree a little further on. Mm. I believe them because they are Australian bushmen and I respect their judgment.
Yes. Teresa, it's an interesting conundrum you've provided here. Not only have you provided the book, but at the same time, we have got so much history in the Hunter Valley that if someone could just... lean off what they're doing for a little while, give as much time and devotion to it as you have, we could have little booklets springing up maintaining our history. It's It's been fantastic talking to you. Especially when we get the picture of you not having any desire to write one originally.
I've been very lucky.
Stop the washing up and write a book.
I've been very lucky. I'm liberated. I don't have to go to work. My husband is quite happy to provide for us. And I have probably a little bit more time to do these things than other people.
I guess we can all be very, very proud that you had that time, Therese. Otherwise, Barrington House then and now may never have been born. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for asking me.
Well, our two guests today, firstly, a journalist of 40-odd years in the Hunter Valley, Matt Hayes, and secondly, Therese Atchison from Lambton, who's put down for all time some of the early story of the Barrington House at Barrington Tops. I hope you've enjoyed today's program, and I hope, too, that you can join us again when next we meet to hear more from the Valley's people. Goodbye for now.